Electrical planning is often the most challenging portion of a home renovation. In this video, let me try and simplify it for you.
If you're not sure of how to begin your renovation, go to Home Trust. Home Trust is Singapore's leading renovation platform that matches homeowners with trusted interior designers. On the main page, simply click the Get Recommendations feature and answer a few simple questions to get matched with reputable IDs. From there, you can check out their portfolios and take a look at their reviews. Did you know that Home Trust do not delete negative reviews? This is where Home Trust stands out, by providing the promise of trust and transparency to homeowners like ourselves. If you want to know more, make sure you visit their website at hometrust.sg.
So today, we talk about electrical planning. I want to start by stressing the importance of electrical planning because it directly impacts the day-to-day activities when you eventually move. Electricals is the heart and soul of your house, and good electrical planning is the foundation of any successful home renovation. From what I hear, very few IDs will do electrical planning for the homeowners. Very often, they'll just tell you to communicate directly with your electrician to get a quote accordingly. And so, it is very important for you to prepare in advance in order to have an effective communication with your electrician. Otherwise, when the electrician comes down to your house, you might just stare at each other and not know what to do.
The first step of electrical planning is to look at the default electrical diagram the HDB gives to you. You can only access this diagram after your key collection. I highly encourage you to plan weeks and months ahead. And so what you see here is an example of a 3-room BTO. For 4-room BTOs, I managed to borrow a copy here from my neighbour. The layouts are more or less the same. Try your best to understand what is drawn. The arrow on the lighting point tells you which switch is controlling it. For example, you can see that the S1 lighting point is pointing to the S1 switch. In bedroom 2, the S14 is pointing to the S14 switch. When you see two arrows like this over here, it means that it is a two-way switch and can be controlled by two switches. Next, what I did here is to translate this diagram into a more readable format, all using PowerPoint. I have also included a legend to explain what each symbol means. You can draw it in any way you want, as long as you understand it, and as long as the electrician understands what you are trying to say. The next step may require a bit more brain power. Because electrical planning eventually impacts your day-to-day activities, you need to begin planning with the end in mind. So you need to have a clear idea of where you are going to position all your furniture, and only then you can then plan your sockets and lighting points around it. What you see here is my sofa, and I have a double socket on the left side and the right side of my sofa. Same for the bed, I have double sockets planned on both sides of the bed. Now near the study table, I have also planned out more sockets to connect our monitors and computers. Within the kitchen, you will also need to know where you'll be placing your appliances so that you can cater sockets for them. For our house, we are going to have a high number of appliances in the service yard, so you can see the number of sockets we have drawn over here. Additionally, you will also need to inform your electrician what kind of appliances you will be using, especially in the kitchen. Because certain appliances has higher electrical consumption and requires a direct point from the DB. The most common example is the induction hob. That usually requires 16 or 20 amperes. Other higher consumption appliances are your built-in ovens, your washer dryers. In general, anything that produces heat will consume more energy. With this information, the electrician can then plan out how much electrical load to allocate to each socket, and this is to ensure electrical safety in your house, and that the circuit breaker does not trip. Another thing to take note here is that for BTOs, the combined electrical limit for the entire house is 40 amperes. So what this means is that at any one point in time, if you use more than 40 amperes, the circuit breaker will trip. So do not go and buy an induction hob that consumes 32 amperes and turn on your water heater, your oven, your aircon, your microwave all at the same time. For condos, the limit is higher, so they will not have this problem. Lately, power tracks like this has become very common. For those of you who are planning to do power tracks, I suggest you to go for the longer ones because the whole purpose of it is to let you shift your sockets to wherever you want on the track itself. If you buy a short track, it really defeats the purpose of a power track. For our case, we felt that there wasn't a need for power tracks if sockets are planned properly. Also, while power tracks looks very cool, but when it is actually in use, you need to plug a 3-pin plug into an adapter and then the adapter into the power track, which I find it to be a lot of protrusion, so in the end we didn't went for the power tracks. However, this is just a matter of personal preference, there's no right or wrong here on the power tracks. Now when it comes to lighting points, it is also good to plan it around your furniture and carpentry. For example, I know the position of my dining table and I have catered a few downlights for it. Also, I have LED strips all around the house, especially under the kitchen top cabinet. Inside the service yard, I have also shifted the original lighting point to cater for the automated laundry rack. If you are going for ceiling fans, all the positions also matter. Possibly in future videos, I will do one on lighting design and how to plan for lighting, because it can be a whole new topic on its own. Also, for each lighting point and ceiling fan, you should ideally know which switch controls it. From there, you can know the amount and type of switches to buy. For those of you who are into smart home, it adds yet another layer of complexity into electrical planning. For example, you can start thinking about which button is physically wired into the lighting points and which button is a scene switcher. I myself will admit that I'm not very good at smart home, but the general recommendation here is that if you're going for the smart home, consider to ask your electrician for neutral wires for all your switches. There are some switches that doesn't require neutral, but they generally do not last a long time and they spoil easily. And that is all I shall cover for electrical planning theory. This topic can definitely go into much further detail, but all in all, do make sure that you take the time to think it through over and over again, because the entire process can take a long time, but trust that it is worth the effort, and you'll be thankful that you have planned it all beforehand.
So the whole idea of drawing your electrical plan is to minimize the miscommunications with your electrician. So you have to draw it in such a way such that any electrician, when they have a look at it, they will be able to understand you. Also, I have spoke to a few electricians to get my own quotation. So at the time of this video, here is an example of a market rate when it comes to itemized electrical charges. So try not to get overcharged for these items. Now, before the actual day of electricals, it is a good idea for you to actually use pencil to mark out all the lighting points, the switches, and all the socket points. Additionally, it can be a good idea to print out your electrical diagram like this and paste it all over the house. The whole idea, again, is to minimize the miscommunication between you and the electrician. Also, I highly recommend that you go down on site during the actual day of electrical works. This is so that all the errors that are done can be rectified immediately. And additionally, you get to understand what is actually happening to the house.
And that is all for part 1 of our electrical planning video. I hope you find this helpful. In part 2, we will be talking about what happens during the day of electrical works, what to take note, and where are the cheapest places to buy your sockets and switches. So stay tuned for the next video. If you find this video helpful, do consider subscribing, and we shall see you in the next one. Bye!